Can't believe you never saw the tree.
I've never seen the tree. I'm from New York. I mean, why would I see the tree? It's only for out of towners.
What's this?
What's going on?
I want to give you this. You guys ever been to Mexico?
To Mexico? We're not going to Mexico. We got a plan. We're going to leave in a couple
you don't
days.
Have a plan. Please, please. Listen, you guys, you know, you're a little bit more exposed than you should be.
Yeah,
no, I think you guys got to get out of the country. Okay? These guys, they're not going to let you go. They're never going to forget about this. It's not going to go unpunished, ever. Okay, I've thought this through.
We got a plan, all right?
Yeah, we
got to
go.
We got to go.
This is the way out of it.
I'm trying to fix this.
No, you pretended like you were our friend and you exploited us.
Think for a second.
Rosie, get in the car.
What'd you
think? Rosie, get in the car.
You're smarter than this, Tommy. You know what's going to happen.
For all
these guys, Tommy, take these tickets.
Close the door.
You got to get out of here.
Gotta go.
You got to get out of here.
Baby, close the door.
Find these tickets here, Tommy. Use these tickets.
Don't want your tickets.
Just keep driving,
close
all right?
Close the door.
Opening. We have an eye, sort of a nostril, two teeth. One of the teeth has a small cavity. Close call, folks, but I think we got here just in time.
Presented by Maria Menounos and Kevin Undergaro. This is Anatomy of a Movie. In-depth discussions and breakdowns of various movie titles. And now that you've seen the movie, let the dissection begin.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Anatomy of a Movie. I'm here hosting. My name is Sara Stretton. And today, we started with a clip because we're doing something a little bit different. Instead of our normal dissection, we have a wonderful guest here who we're going to interview, who's the director of Rob the Mob, and that was the clip that you just saw. He is an Oscar-nominated director for the short Bronx Cheers. He's also done City Island and all these wonderful films, so we're so excited to have you here. This is Raymond De Felitta.
Beautifully pronounced, and I'm only sorry that you're not going to dissect me. So
we can try. We'll dissect
we'll
your
goes,
brain.
Yeah.
We're going to pick and prod and ask annoying questions because everyone wants to know like what goes on behind the camera and creates these masterful films. So
where do you find out what went on behind the camera with the scene you just watched?
I already want to know.
Yeah, that's,
what is it? What do you mean?
We'll get there. I'll let you pull it out. I'll let you dissect it.
I have to probe, make things difficult. Okay, so Rob the Mob. Is a thriller about these two kind of rambunctious star-crossed lovers who decide that the best way to make some money is robbing the mafia.
It was actually a good idea if you look at it from a certain perspective, from a certain kind of skewered, kind of ailing perspective.
Okay. Do the obvious, the most risky thing out there. And
well, who's going to call the police if you're from the mob? That was one thing that Tommy Uva thought. It's like they're not going to call the cops. Let's say they do call the cops. The cops are going to say, yes, you know, Mr. Mafioso, we're going to go get your money back for you. Like, there was logic to Tommy Uva's plan. There was also vengeance involved because he thought that his father had been offed by the mob years ago. His father was a local business owner who mysteriously was found dead. It was ruled a accident by shotgun going off, like cleaning the gun. You know that whole story that you never believe.
And it ends up being true because always the most ridiculous things are the true parts.
Well, true, but you know, really, I own a gun. I'm going to polish it up and point it in my face. Who does that, really? You know, usually they have some odd connection to you know someone in organized crime or something. Anyway, so there were good reasons. Let's put it that way. And I think what he was really thinking, and that he and Rosemarie, his partner, were thinking, was it's an idea that is so outlandish, it's so incomprehensibly bizarre that nobody will really know how to respond to it. And they were right for a while that people didn't really know what to do. The mob didn't know whether to chase them. Do you order a hit on this? Do you make a big deal out of it? But as they kept doing it, and they did it a number of times, it became a serious embarrassment. And then finally, a piece of evidence fell into their hands that made it a serious problem for the mob.
And that's where you get the twists and turns. And obviously, the FBI comes in. You've got all these other authorities. And that also just heightens the excitement of this movie, is that you've got the love, you've got the mob, and then on top of that, you get the unexpected turns of the police, and where is this blame going to fall, and how, I mean, You said that it might be obvious how it turns out, but to me, there's so much unpredictability because it's uncharted territory. I mean, mafia movies have been done for decades, and they're some of my favorites, actually. And so I'm excited for this little twist. This is based off a true story.
Yeah.
About a real couple. What really drew you into this story? What was inspiring to you, or what did you think you could show in directing this film?
Well, I didn't at the time that I first read the script know this term, but I'll introduce you to the term. So okay. we're doing a market research screening of the movie, and at those screenings, they always go to the focus group, and they say, could you describe this movie? Well, how would you tell your friend about it? And so some people, because it's a hard movie to describe, some people say, oh, it's a romance. No, it's a comedy. No, it's really a crime genre, you know, movie. And then this one guy raises his hand, and he says, it's a fiasco flick. And we look at each other and we're like, what is a fiasco for? And he goes, you know, it's a movie where you know from the beginning that what they're doing is going to go wrong, but you really enjoy watching it all fall apart.
You enjoy watching the crash.
And I went, oh my God, that's why I did this movie. I love fiasco flicks. I love Dog Day Afternoon. I love Deliverance. I mean, they're
just
coming.
Like everything that's messy.
I love, look, The Producers, classic fiasco flick. You know, things that you go, oh my God, I know that this isn't going to work out, but I love watching the madness of the pursuit and how are they going to get through it. And if at the end in this new genre that this guy, who I'll never meet again probably, seems to have invented, if in the end of a fiasco flick you go, oh my God, yes, it all went wrong, but there's some bigger purpose that was served by the whole thing, then I think you have something, you're in like really interesting territory for really kind of cinematic storytelling. So that's why I did it, but I wouldn't have known it at the time. I just, something drew me to the idea that, oh my God, these two people did the craziest thing. I'm totally with them, and at the same time, I know you're driving off a cliff, you know?
At the same time, you're crazy. Well, you mentioned that it does relate to a bigger picture, and that these like one stories, you know, unveil something bigger about the world. What do you think that means for this film?
Well, I mean, I think one thing that happened that Tommy and Rosie really did have an impact on was they had an impact on the investigation that was going on in general with all the mob families at the time. And the mob was beginning to really fall apart. That was also one of Tommy's plans at the time, was that he felt, because of the Gotti trial, which was the fourth and last time Gotti was going to be tried, he was like, the mob, they've got bigger fish to fry. We are not going to be on their radar. They're just going to let this go. So again, I love when a story, when characters can do something that is heroic and they don't even mean it to be. Again, that's just like a great kind of way to tell heroism, because of there's course. Nothing noble about it, but they're noble in spite of themselves.
Yeah, in spite, it's like even the smallest actions can actually be the biggest. And people who don't have the intention of going out there and making a big storm, showing a big picture, they can make the biggest impact.
The German version of this movie would be Schindler's List. How about that?
That's an interesting comparison.
Yeah, that's probably like the greatest insult I could possibly make to World War II movies. Okay, but I did it.
The mob,
and I did it for
Tommy
you.
Tommy and Rosie, thank you. Yeah. I really appreciate that. That's going to be the quote, the title of this. We're going to put greatest insult.
Right.
World War II movies is no. So you all have been a writer, director, producer. This movie, how is it different just directing a movie versus writing and directing a film?
Yeah, it's interesting because when you write a movie, you're directing it. So it's like there's a lot less work when you finally, the work is in trying to get the money together and the experience to happen. But once you've done it, you've worked it out. This is different because I'm taking someone else's material. This was not a case of just taking a finished screenplay and shooting it. I worked with the writer, Jonathan Fernandez, on it. It was really taking it and filtering it through my interests, the way I saw the characters. So in a sense, I did that. But I also had to work harder because I was coming at actors and saying to them, hey, I'm learning this with you. We have to do this together. I'm going to have these perceptions of these people. Let's discover it together. You're not just going to turn to me and automatically say, oh, you wrote it. What was in your head? Because I didn't. I'm not the writer. But that made me work harder. You know, that just made me a better director, really.
So in the process, Jonathan Fernandez writes the script, and then do you get brought in first before the actors? Like, how much time do you get to go over notes, to find that compromise so you have the same vision? Like, how much time do you spend doing that before progressing to casting?
Yeah, the film came, the script came to me, you know, 3 years ago, 4 years ago, something like that. And we didn't work on the script at all. The first thing we did was say, let's just take a wild shot because, to my mind and to my producer, Bill Tytler, Michael Pitt was like the obvious Tommy. And we just thought, let's get it over with. Let's send it to him. Let's get him to reject it.
I'm a huge Michael Pitt fan. I'm really excited. I've covered Boardwalk Empire.
Yeah.
Great show. Also Gangsters.
He's so special. There's not one of another of him in that place right now, you know. But I thought, like, let's just give it a shot. He'll probably turn us down, then we can get to work, you know. And then he didn't. He liked it. So all of a sudden, I'm with Michael, and we're talking about how could we do this. And then a lot of time from that point on got spent trying to cast Rosie.
Mm-hmm.
And we really hadn't gotten to the script at all. We just started to try to package the movie, and we said, well, you know, well, let's just see what happens. And then things got really slow because what happens, at the time, the company that said they were going to finance the movie said, oh, that's great. We love Michael Pitt. Now go get one of these girls and, you know, you've got a movie. And the list is, of course, Scarlett Johansson, Mila Kunis, you know, and you're like, it doesn't matter.
So it's going to take me 3 months to get through their answering machine.
Yeah, to get the no from the manager. Not even the, you know, it's so boring. I mean, and I've been through this for too long, and I knew it was probably... But we wasted the time. We did the work because it's what you have to do. And after just too much time going by, Bill Tytler said to me, what if we made the movie for a lot less and kind of freed ourselves up from that list? Because Michael should be enough to justify, you know, making the movie at this price. And so we rolled up our sleeves. We figured that out. And Nina Arianda, who I had seen on Broadway in Venus and Furs, and who's just a phenomenal.
And
yeah, I mean, her movie parts are great, but they're small. She hadn't had a lead, but I'd seen her on Broadway. And she's, you know, she's a force. She's a total force. And we offered it to her. She got it. And I have to say, the people who financed the movie, they were behind it. There was a little bit of like, you know, is there like, don't you want like a really cheesy name for the video for the DVD box? No, but there was very little of that. They got it. They understood. I said to them at one point, you're going to be so proud when it's done that we have Nina. So like, take the leap because she's going to be so ungettable in another movie or two. Trust me, and she will. You know. I had this experience happen to me with Jessica Chastain, where there was a moment where she wanted to do something that I was involved in, and the financiers, who I will not tell you, like they laughed. They were like, please, Jessica who, you know.
You need to have an I told you so card.
Oh, yeah.
Just a sign you can hold up and be like, see?
I actually know a guy, a director, Randall Kleiser, who he had a T-shirt like he was wearing one day. I was working with him something, and his T-shirt said, I passed on Tom Cruise. I said, really? And he said, oh, yeah, 1982, right before Risky Business. I turned him down.
Owning it.
Yeah, just you got to be, what else?
You have to.
How else do you deal with that? Yeah.
Well, at least you can say the other side, like, I knew. I knew before, and that's fantastic. I mean, you've got a great group of actors in this. So you're talking about you reached out and you offered her this role. Did you go through the typical casting auditions, or was it really just because you knew she was a powerhouse?
No, I mean, I, you know, as a formality, I said, would you come in and like read with Michael and stuff, but she knew it wasn't an audition, you know, and with actors like that, an audition's not either they're not going to want to do it, or it's not truly necessary. Auditioning in general is a kind of horrible, you know, and not really helpful process, you know. In fact, I don't even really like to see auditions live. I usually ask to just put them on tape because it's less uncomfortable for me to sit in a room with someone who's like nervous and trying to do it. But I also think it's better for them. They don't feel like they're doing it once for the director. They're alone with the camera. They do it. Maybe they do it a couple times.
You get to like see if what you want to put out there as the actor who's auditioning, like they can be proud of what they're sending in. They don't have like the actor's remorse of getting that nervousness or having that wall, they can be much more open, I'm sure.
Some don't like it because, you know, they kind of want to engage with you and say, do you want something else or, you know, but I don't know. It's my own personal thing, though. I'm usually happier to just see them on tape.
But then you brought in Andy Garcia, who you'd worked with before in City Island. Did you envision him from this role right away as Big Al?
Big Al kind of developed as we went along. One of the things I wanted to do when I took the project on was I thought, you know, I never really thought about making a mob movie, first of all, because it's kind of a losing deal. You know, it's you're not going to top.
How so?
Well, you're going to top Godfather. You're going to top Goodfellas. You're going to beat The Sopranos. It's like it's you know.
I mean, I don't think you have to try and top it. I think you always just have to kind of. If you idolize something or you really enjoy something, then you have to take it on from a different angle. Like, you don't, in
true,
my opinion, you
but,
don't want to, like, recreate. Like, you're not going to recreate The Godfather and top it.
But no, but the problem with mob movies is they're either incredibly great or really poor. Like, there's very few that are just, you know. But when I read this, I thought, well, it's not really a mob movie. It has to do with them, but they're not the mob that you've seen. Mm-hmm. They're like this sort of exhausted, you know, lost, these old guys sitting there. It's like, you know, they don't know what to do. They're baffled. What do we do with the kid with the Uzi? You know, and I kind of loved that. I thought that's a new wrinkle. I haven't, so I'm not doing the mob as I think, you know, we usually have seen it.
Identify with the mob as this, like, big powerhouse guys who are just ready to open fire on everyone who walks
or in. Or just utter clowns, you know, mm-hmm. and that's boring too, I think. So by way of your question about Andy, one of the things I wanted to do was say, well, who's the mob boss who we haven't met? And he, you know, when I gave it to him, he basically said the same thing. I'm not just going to play a mob boss. It has to be something original. So we all started talking about the idea that what if you met a mob boss who we're not even going to try to make scary? It's not about that. He's a guy. He's a grandfather. He's in the kitchen making food with the grandson. He's kind of lost his steam for the whole gig. And in fact, that becomes his fatal error. He has a moment to order their hit early on, and he blows it off. He's just like, you know, this is something like Eagles Don't Hunt Flies. And of course, it winds up undoing him at the end. So I kind of loved, again, the idea that Andy could create a person with me who is not typically, he really has only one moment where you see him as the boss, you know, and it's this group of guys who are, they're like tired from staying up so late, you know.
He has to rally the troops.
Yeah, exactly.
Of course. Well, I'm with Andy, like, you brought out his, like, more comedic side in City Island, and now you're kind of describing him as this new gangster, and then you're also adding in Ray Romano. I mean, when I'm thinking about this, I'm thinking about this as, like, a drama, thriller. Is there a comedic edge to this film? Because, I mean, you're bringing in some serious comedic actors.
But it's not with Ray. I mean, and in fact, I think that the comedy that's in the film happens because of the situations. Mm-hmm. It's like we never tried to play anything for comedy. It was always just the truth of, you know, what would Tommy do with an Uzi? Well, he would be brave enough and stupid enough to wield it, but he's not really going to bother to figure out how it works. So the first time he takes the club, it just goes out of control, and he actually scares everyone. You know, he doesn't even really mean to, but... And I think that that works because it comes out of his character. Ray Romano is not a funny character at all, and he's... but what he brought to it, which I think he brings to his comedy, is very human. It's very empathic.
Yeah, you have to be very open. Like, you have to, I think the key to his comedic, like, personality is that he is so vulnerable all the time. Mm-hmm. And so playing a role that is straight or serious as an FBI agent, being able to see it's very easy to connect to his humanity. I'm sure that's very valuable.
Yeah.
In an actor, and them being just be able to, you can see them. That's great.
Yeah, and he was just very his acting is just very relaxed and genuine. It's not acting at all, which is funny because he's very modest and keeps saying, like, did I act? Was that enough? And I was like, no, you didn't. That's perfect, right? That's exactly what you were, just the guy. You just did it. He wasn't there to bring comedy. He was just there in fact, I offered him a different role originally, and it's because it's the role that Griffin Dunne plays, which is, you know, Griffin's really funny,
uh-huh.
And it's more of a kind of a comedic turn. It's the guy who runs the collection agency, and Ray called me, and he's like, I really like this project. I don't think I really want to do that part. He said, I feel like I've kind of done that. That's the funny part. I want to do the reporter. And I thought, originally, I was like, oh, that's interesting. I didn't picture it at all. But I've learned over the years that if a good actor wants to do something, even if it's not exactly what you originally thought of, you should just go with them, because they know they've got something, and then they're going to give you something. It's going to be better than what you thought.
People are passionate about what they're doing.
Yeah,
they want to do more.
And I thought, like, yeah, I can go with Ray Romano in this. I love him. I think he's super. You know, he's beyond funny. He's always had that human, strange, you know, both dry and warm thing that he has. And so I was like, yeah, I'd love you to show up. Yeah.
I feel like this movie's been a very collaborative, and like as you talk about it, I feel like you guys were almost operating as like a family. Did people's inputs, whether actors or writers, change anything dramatically from the original version? Like, are there any huge switches that you didn't expect?
From the original script or
the original script.
Yeah, it was always something that was fluid. It was something that we were working on all the time. Michael was really good about, like, he really wanted to work on Tommy and the truth of what his character would do. And Jonathan Fernandez, the writer, stayed on through the whole thing. I had him on the set through the whole movie. You know, I wanted him to feel that we weren't taking his work and shredding it. We were taking something that he'd started with, and we were molding it into something, which, in a way that I've always wanted to work. You know, it's the way Robert Altman made movies, and he was a hero of mine, and someone who I was very fortunate to get to know towards the end of his life. And the thing that I always caught from the people he worked with around him was, like, you don't really know you're working. You're all just contributing, and he's just bringing you in, bringing your ideas, bringing your talent. And I would always, which I loved, is they'd say, we forgot the camera was rolling. And that's how you get Altman performances. But it's really just Altman giving everyone that loose and collaborative vibe. And I wanted to do that with this movie a lot, because the style of this movie worked for that, too.
You can embrace the fun. Do you have any crazy stories from the set? Any shenanigans of castmates, crewmates?
No, it was crazy enough without, you know, any crazy stories. It was a lot of work, was the thing. This movie got shot in 26 days, which was short for the script.
Very much. So where were you shooting? It takes place in New York. I know that one of your locations was in New York. Did you shoot anywhere else?
We were in Queens, mostly. Okay. We were basically in every cruddy location New York has left to offer. You know, I mean, it was like, because New York's been shot out. All the good stuff's been shot out. So we were trying to make up for all of the nice places that, like, Woody Allen is shot in, and, you know, that Sex and the City shot in. We're like, all the filler, all the junk in between was, like, the mob location.
And I have a feeling you love New York, though, because a lot of your films, from Bronx Cheer, City Island, they take places like Staten Island, the Bronx, New York City. Like, where does your connection to New York stem from, and what do you find so fascinating about it?
Well, I was born there. My parents were born there. My grandparents emigrated to New York. But none of that is really the right answer. The weird thing is that I've written a whole bunch of things that have never been made, and a lot of them don't take place in New York. For some reason, I mean, and this is just the movie business, you don't have a lot of control over what gets done a lot of time. Mm-hmm. So it turns out that I've made this group of movies that all seem to be about the outer boroughs in New York, but it's like that accounts for like a tenth of what I've tried to write and make. But maybe there's a reason.
People just see you as a New Yorker.
Maybe there's like the film God Sees Me is like, no, Raymond, you're not doing the Western. You're not supposed to do...
No California.
Yeah, I've written them. I mean, I think Hollywood's fascinating. I think, you know, I think L.A. is, you know, and I've lived in L.A. on and off over the years for a lot. But for some reason, these are the movies I've gotten made, and I am fascinated with it because I think, you know, a couple of things. One is that the outer borough life in New York really doesn't get portrayed a lot in movies. Mm-hmm. People tend to think of the only thing that's going on in the outer boroughs are the mob, and the rest of it's like glamour, and that's kind of the movies in New York. But, you know, the New York's filled with the police and the secretaries and the teachers and
everybody else.
And everyone else, and they don't get represented a lot. So I've written a lot about that.
No. Not just your normal life. And where did you grow up in New York?
But, you know, it's funny. Everyone's is like, City Island, so you're from the Bronx. So I was like, no, my parents escaped from the Bronx. I grew up on the Upper West Side.
All right. And do you live by coastal, or are you in New York?
Yeah, both. No? I'm in both. Yeah.
I'm an LA girl. So New York and the Bronx and all that is such a foreign world to me. And I think that's partially why I get attracted to movies that take place in like the big city and everything like that. Because everything's so fast-paced. Everything's moving so quickly. And I think that probably really lends itself to a film like this, where, you know, you have the guns, you have the drama, everything like that. You mentioned that you've written other scripts that don't take place in New York. Do you have anything coming up that you're working on? What's in the future for you?
No, I've kind of given up doing anything that doesn't take place in New York. It's like they've given me like the sign. Like, it's not going to happen, Raymond. Don't waste what precious time you have left. Just keep writing. I have this comedy I've been trying to make for several years called Married and Cheating, and that's a New York comedy, so, you know.
I mean, then it probably has some good luck attached to it. You said people love your New York stuff.
I hope so, yeah.
What got you into directing and creating films? Like, you went to AFI.
Yeah, American Film Institute.
And but what got you there? Like,
well, I actually grew up around it. My father's a writer and made documentary films, and so I, if you grow up around it, you don't think it's an insane pursuit. It's just like that's what dad does. He sits in the room and writes.
It's normal. What are you talking
about? Yeah, it's like inheriting the family pub. You know, it's sort of like, yeah, I'll just take it over and I'll do it. And then like later on, you realize, no, schmuck. You know, it's not a good idea. It's really
were your parents always supportive of
totally, you? Yeah, okay. Yeah. They saw that I loved writing and storytelling, and yeah, I was, you know, I was one of those. Making films since I was, I mean, Super 8 was high tech when I was, you know, started making films. That's how old I am. It was the new one because it wasn't 8, it was Super 8.
Do you remember, what was the first film you ever made? As a kid.
Like. Yeah, I remade several Three Stooges movies. Literally, like, with, and I wasn't
thinking.
Who'd
you cast?
Oh, you know, like, kids who I could bully, right? I was like, no, hit him again. Hit him, you know, with the eye, poke the eye. I was like, you know, kids who I could,
are
like,
you a
force.
A bully director?
You know what? I got a lot nicer.
Okay.
Yeah. I got a lot nicer. When I found out that I couldn't get films made without the actors, I switched my tactics. But yeah, originally it was sort of like whatever kids I could sort of strong arm, I would make films with
them.
I didn't think they were remakes either. I just sort of thought that, well, that's what a film is. It's where the three detectives get on the train and right? It's like, so there were Three Stooges were like, that was my drama school basically.
Oh, that's good inspiration. And then you did go to real drama school. What made you decide to go to school instead of just going straight out there and directing?
Well, at the time I went, and AFI was a great period in my life, but at that time we were still in pre-digital. In fact, really independent film as a mainstream crossover like had not even happened. So I'm talking about like the mid to late 1980s. Mm-hmm. Like Jim Jarmusch, Spike, all of that's just starting to happen. So to say that you want to direct a movie is basically like saying, well, I think I'll be president of the United States. It's just like this unreachable goal at that time. So the way to do it, I thought, rather than just hoping that it might happen one day, is we'll go to film school and really kind of envision yourself and position yourself as the director guy. I'm going to train to be a director. And that's at the time, it was also a way to get equipment. You needed so much more to make a film. You know, it's like that 16mm camera was such a great get at the time. My God, the school's going to give us that, and I've got lighting equipment, and it's just a dead culture now. That's no longer the story.
Now you just need a flip phone.
You know, and it's so much better because so much less time and energy and money wasted. You know, it's hard to make the first bunch of mistakes that you learn from. When you make a film and you have to spend a lot of money doing it. But if you're going to go out and shoot, you know, nice and loose and learn to do it, I mean, people are learning to do it, you know, really quickly now.
Yeah, and I mean, I asked because I went to school for like acting and theater and film. And it's very interesting to me just to see that change of who's still going to school, who's going directly out there. And I think a big part of it is how accessible filming is and how much people can do now just like on their home computer, on their own equipment. But I'm a big advocate of school, so I think that's great. What did you use to film Rob the Mob? What were you guys filming?
Alexa.
On? Okay.
Yeah.
You're like, yeah. We're good.
Oh yeah. Yeah. No need to go back to that. I mean, because the City Island,
you don't
I
want
shot,
to lug all that stuff around?
You know, I don't not? You know, oh, because there's not enough grain. I mean, what is that with the grain? I don't know why that's people are
but
so.
People want to add in the grain.
They add in the grain
because they wanted to make it.
We were supposed to get rid of the grain. I'm not sure where the grain became the center of filmmaking.
Some things look too realistic.
Right.
That's a problem.
But so did the first film where the train went at the camera and the people in the audience went running out of the theater.
Yeah.
So wasn't that the idea that it was supposed? I don't know. Anyway, I don't care about the grain. I care about performances and I care about. It feeling, you know, real. And the way to do that for me, I've found, is to be able to shoot and keep shooting and let people try stuff. And every day at the end of City Island, which was shot in 35, you know, I had to have the conversation with the Bond people. Why are you shooting so much film? You have to shoot less film. And it was just, I thought that it's the end of that era, you know. I'm not trying to make the budget, I'm trying to make the film. And you now can do both at the same time.
So. That's very true. I mean,
wasn't that a nice little bite? That nice little sound bite, the budget and the film, and you can do both at the. Shouldn't that wind up somewhere else? Yeah. That was nice. And it just came out. I never said that before.
Wrap it up, put it in a little circle.
Yeah, I like that.
There we go.
Yeah.
Talking about that, when you are directing a film and you're going through scenes, like how much rehearsal goes into a given scene? Does it, how many times are you shooting the same thing over and over again? Like, does it vary between actors? How was it for this movie? How did that play out?
You know, for me at this point, rehearsal is really, it's to, you rehearse to kind of block and feel where you're going.
Mm-hmm.
It's very much for me, how much does an actor want? But what I find is that if you get into a good groove, I like to shoot the rehearsal. I just assume we start figuring out where it is and start shooting and start, you know, and once everyone gets comfortable with that, it turns out that rehearsing is not always the most necessary step mm-hmm. in it, because we're no longer worried about burning film. You know, we're going to spend the time doing either. And so things start to get a lot more exciting as opposed to fearful or, let's say, scientific. We have to do it exactly this way. But it depends on what kind of film you're making, though, too. For this movie, for the kind of films I make, I want them to feel alive. I want them to feel like they're happening in front of you.
Okay, I have two questions. Well, I have more questions, but I'm going to go with these two first.
But these seem to be like the same theme, though, these two.
They're connected. It's kind of like the positive side of the coin and the negative side of the coin. What was the hardest job of being the director on this movie, and what was your favorite part of being the director on this movie, or as a director in general?
Let's see. Well, I'm sure what a lot of people would love to hear is that the hardest job was working with Michael Pitt, because for some reason, Michael has this, I keep getting asked by people, was Michael Pitt difficult? I'm like, I'm not really sure where this happened.
I think he has a little bit of a bad boy look to him. And so
it's so weird. Like, cause actually to answer the second part of your question, like the best part of the experience for me was working with Michael, you know, and Nina,
mm-hmm.
they were the movie. But Michael was involved earlier, so he and I really kind of bonded very early on, and you know, and I would say to him, like, this is very much our thing. It's like mm-hmm. we have to be symbiotic in what we're doing, and I find that immensely satisfying with an actor. You can, you know, you can create that and literally go. I mean, those are my role models. All have done that. You know, it's certainly what Scorsese and De Niro had with each other. You know,
a partnership.
Yeah. Yeah, because then you're each doing the same job. It's not mm-hmm. like, well, I'm not directing you, you're not resisting me. You know, we're not having that, which I think is nonsense. What's the hardest part? Honestly, it's the schedule and the you have to avoid trying to be a nice guy and please everybody who wants you to quit at a certain time. I mean, I don't like to work long hours either, but I've noticed that people are really unnaturally obsessed with how great it is when directors work short days. And I'm sorry, it takes me so much time to put this movie together. It takes so much energy to get everyone out there. I'm not working a short day. And, you know, even if we can quit early, let's find more to do.
Mm-hmm.
Because, yeah, you're only out there once. You're only, you know, and so a lot of the time, and it's difficult, it's taxing, but I would kind of have to go to everyone and say, if I can squeeze another hour, you know, if we have some more OT, I really need you to pitch in, because I don't want to cut shots and I don't want to have to drop things. And no one ever said no. You know, I think that's a testament to people feeling good about that we're all collaborating on something together.
Okay, and as you said, you did have a pretty short shoot overall in general, just
26 days.
26 yeah. days. And then after you're done with those shooting times, and getting through all of that and taking actual shots, how long does it take for you to get through the editing process, the selection of shots? And do you go in kind of remembering, like, oh, I remember this camera angle, this scene, and I know I want to use that going in? How do you organize that, and how long does it take?
Well, my editor, David Leonard, and I have done several movies mm-hmm. together, so he starts when I'm shooting, and I'm very comfortable with him starting to assemble stuff.
So you have everyone there. You've got writer, you've got editor.
Well, but you kind of have to mm-hmm. do that now. I mean, no movie with a real completion date it can wait around for the director to be done anymore. Your mm-hmm. assembly starts while you're shooting. but the point is in that, it's that I'm comfortable with, like, his selection of material is usually very close to mine. I'm surprised at how much I do remember later. I don't know why. Like I don't try to remember this stuff, but sometimes I'll just go, look at take four of that, and it's suddenly in my head, and there's something that I'm like, oh yeah, that's right. I don't know why it's lodged there, but it's all still fresh enough. So I guess I would say it's not a short process, but it's not as long as it probably should be, because I have an editor who I'm comfortable with putting together a lot, and then once he and I get cooking. And then we did an interesting thing on this movie with the music, which also kind of condensed the post time, which is I've always thought it was very frustrating. I love using music when we edit, and I love finding temp score, you know, to use to get just what's the feeling of this movie and what's the kind of music we want. The problem with the temp is that it kind of sticks like glue to the movie. You never want to get rid of it once you've found good temp. And so then you bring a composer in, and the poor composer is just like, they're in the worst position in the world. You see, okay, you want me to basically imitate like these five different movie scores that you piece together, you know, and then they don't
make them flow and make it work.
Yeah, so I said this time, I said, why do we always wait until like pictures lock to bring in a composer? It's insane. Why don't we start having him do so? I went to Steven Endelman, who I did another movie, Two Family House, with, and I said, why don't we start you as soon as I'm done and I start working with David? You start writing themes, we'll start like just putting them in, and we'll just write the score simultaneously with our editing it, which it made so much sense. I wonder, like, are we violating some union contract? There must be some wrinkle out there that I'm not aware of, because I don't know why you wouldn't
just
do it that
progress.
Way.
Progress.
Maybe I'm not the first person to think of this either. Probably not. But I just haven't heard of it done before, and it's a great way to work.
When you create these themes, do you create them sequentially, the music? Do you pick pivotal scenes first? How does that go about? I know you know a lot about music. You classical, like jazz.
Well, I'm a jazz musician, which means I'm really kind of a dope addict, so I'm not all that, you know.
But you helped with a song on this, I know.
Yeah, well, Stephen and I co-wrote a song, which I can tell you about if you insist. If you twist my arm.
I am insisting.
But no,
Come on.
In this case, Stephen has this studio in Hollywood, and it's quite nice and has like an extra room in it. And I said, why don't we edit in there? You start, like, pick where you want to start. What scene do you like? And fly the cue into us. And he picked, like, a really emotional cue. He picked, like, Tommy and Rosie, I think the marriage proposal on the roof scene. And I thought, wow, that's, like, a really kind of big place to go from the very, just start there, you know. But it was so beautiful, and we put it against picture. And we went, okay, that's kind of the tone of Tommy and Rosie now. That's what we wanted to feel like.
Oh, well, I'm sure that getting enraptured in such a moment really pulls you in and allows you to kind of go from there. Do you have a favorite musical section in this film?
Well, I love the Tommy and Rosie, you know, theme because it's so unexpected in the context of a movie called Rob the Mob. And that's what I wanted to do. I didn't want to make a movie that just felt like one thing. I wanted it to have that kind of skewered, you know, yes, it's a genre film, but it's four different genres, and it's going to change every 10 minutes or so, and we're going to somehow wrap it all together, I hope. And so I think that's what I really love that Steven did, because he said, you know, by doing that, he basically said, we can break your heart with a movie that is about the mob and kids and Uzis, so.
And those are some of my favorite films, the ones who do, like, play with your emotions. You don't really get what you expect going in.
Right.
I think we'll find that with this movie. And now I'm going to twist your arm. I want to know about this love and the gun.
Yeah. Well, there's this great Italian pop star named Mina. And Mina's songs are in Goodfellas, actually.
Okay.
So we were looking, when we were looking for source cues, we tried a Mina song against something, and it was just great. It was just kind of 60s Italian pop thing. Like, it just had this wonderful vibe. And then we found out, which we didn't realize, that that's essentially licensing Mina. It's like trying to license Barbra Streisand. It's just a hopeless. It's going to cost too much, and it's going to take 5 years, and it's going to be, you know,
approved and go through all these layers.
It's never going to happen, basically. Okay. So Stephen and I, before looking for other songs, we thought, like, well, what is this recording really? It's a very skillfully done, but a very exact, very specific kind of genre, and it involves strings, and it involves Italian vocals, and it involves a slightly Bond kind of, vibe to the whole thing. And so we said, well, just write it. So very early one morning, I quickly wrote like a scratch lyric, and it wasn't very good. But when I reread it, I thought, actually, it's sort of funny because it sounds like a lyric that was translated from another language. Because it's just a little stiff and a little like I was just trying to put something together. And I thought, okay, we're done. Because that's what it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be an Italian pop song that got translated.
Okay.
And then so Steven put a melody to it, and that's hopefully going to be probably the only way any of us are going to make any money on this movie is if the song becomes a bizarre hit.
So we need to get the song, and we need to put it behind this interview.
I thought we were.
Yeah, that's what we're doing.
That's what she told me. Obviously. She told me that. That was not...
And now the debate ensues. Right. We need you to agree to it. We needed your approval. That was me getting through the layers, you know?
Finally.
I just cut straight through questioning, and
that's
what I wanted.
We could have skipped this whole conversation, basically,
yep,
is what you're saying.
We're done? No, we can continue. But so we've talked a lot. In music, film, writing, what are your dreams and aspirations for the next, I don't know, 5-10 years? What do you want to happen?
Well, you know, assuming the art form continues, assuming we get to do the 2-hour narrative, which I think we will, but everything changes at some point, and maybe movies are going
to be... What do you think would replace it?
Well, when you see people watching a movie on their watch, you have to start wondering whether, you know, an hour 45 in the dark is going to be part of that culture, whatever that culture is going to morph into. And that's what I know. That's what I grew up learning. That's what I love. That's what I don't. But then again, I'm never intentionally backwards. I don't bear a grudge against the future. So I'd like to grow with it as well. But assuming that this is what we're doing, I mean, the independent film's been threatened with death ever since it first came to life. And it's not. It always goes on somehow. So the way I kind of look at the next 20 years of my life is, can I keep doing that? And can I not be so curmudgeonly and so backwards and so old to not want to make a film for your watch too? Because there might be something to be said for making a film that you can look at on your watch.
Yeah, you just have
seconds.
To somehow make sure all the details show up.
Yeah.
A tiny little picture.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that most of our listeners, and myself included, and at Anatomy of Movie, we're all about going and going to the theaters and seeing these big, beautiful pieces of art like played out with the seats, with the popcorn, with everything, because it's an experience. You want to be able to escape into these other worlds. So I think it's going to continue. I don't think it's going to go into this whole, a lot of people have supposed that we are going to get just like the smaller pictures, and then going to the movies is going to cost, you know, $100, and it's going to be something you do once every couple months. But I really don't think that. I think that film is something that the world embraces, and you just watch like how many people watch the Oscars and how many people want to be part of these worlds and continuously just are showing their support and love of movies. I think there's a great future in it. So
I'm with you, actually. I don't see all that going away. It just is going to be ever more complicated.
I don't like wearing a watch, so yeah. It really can't become a movie watch thing.
And I like wearing old watches. I like my 1958 Bulova. I don't really want a screen that I have to replace this with.
I'm good with just the hands, but you know, wall clock. That was a big surprise when my stepsister didn't like our wall clock because it wasn't digital. I was like, oh no. And now I'm like,
you're not
I'm
going
not
digital
old.
With
and
your
I'm
wall
like,
clock. Yeah.
What's happening? Who knows? But everything does like change. And it's about the good news about change is that we do get these films that are, you know, crossing genres, making blends, finding new approaches, and forever like kind of tweaking, I guess. And that's wonderful. Mm-hmm. You mentioned that you're inspired by Altman. Who are your other inspirations?
Sidney Lumet was a big inspiration to me, I think it was just because when I was growing up, the number of movies he made that they did like what we're talking about, I felt like Network, Dog Day Afternoon, you know, Serpico, Prince of the City. These movies had like such vibrancy. They were very dramatic. They were also alternately funny and dark. You dealt with characters who you didn't necessarily think you wanted to know, and all of a sudden you found like, no, Frank Serpico is actually really a hero in spite of a lot of complicated things you learn about him. And I also loved his energy. Whenever I would hear him speak, or you know, there was just no nonsense to this guy. He was all work, and he made you want to go do it. But I also, I mean, further back when I was growing up, I loved, you know, Billy Wilder when he was I don't want to say I was the first to, you know, but he was in such eclipse at the time. He was really considered kind of old hat. He was still trying to make films. This is in the 70s and early 80s. And I always had so much respect for him as a writer-director. And again, as a force, I guess this is a theme, like with Lumet, with Altman, of like a force that just keeps going. He was his own engine. He was always going to make it his way. He was never going to stop. One thing that Altman said to me that I really cherish was I had Two Family House was maybe going to open, and I said, you know, I don't think they're going to spend enough money. I don't, you know, it turned out I was right. You know, I don't know what's going to happen with the movie.
I told you so, sign.
Yeah, right. And he said, and he said, doesn't matter. Whatever happens, just keep doing it. And I went, that's him. That's how. That's why he's Altman. It's just, you know, the force you need to do this work. It's just so. It's so inhuman that you have to literally get that.
You have to keep pushing. You just always have to keep pushing. I mean, you mentioned earlier, even with, you get handed this material about 3 years ago, and it's that stop starting. If you really want it and are passionate about it, you just have to keep going. And there's going to be like, oh, this person signed on, and that person signed on, and finding money, and all these steps.
And then that person drops off, and you have to start all over again. That happens a lot.
And you're like, ah, such a headache. But it is. It's just that keep pushing for what you love. So, before we wrap up and before we go, I would like to know, is there anything you'd like to tell people who are aspiring to be directors or about like the power of movies and film that you hope to get across in your work?
Seriously? I have to answer that?
Yeah.
After all this nice conversation, you're going to give me that one?
I told you.
How to inspire young directors.
Ha ha.
The answer.
I have to push in like a couple of those questions.
God, yeah. No,
I mean, earlier you guys missed, we went over pizza, and that's a big debate.
You've never heard of eggplant on pizza? That's such a weird thing that, you know, come on.
I've been to like the crafty places.
You haven't been
places.
In New York. That's the thing.
I've been to New York. I just haven't lived in New York.
Okay.
I've been to like the Broadway. I had pizza in New York in line for The Lion King.
Okay. I didn't mean to like lower your brand by saying you'd never been to New York. I take it back.
I'm really insulted.
No, you know what? The thing is, I kind of don't think, you know, young filmmakers, if you're going to do it, you don't need my advice. You know, nothing's going to stop you. But I would say, if you have any other thing in your head going like, I maybe want to do something else, just go do that. Because this is going to take all of your energy. It's going to take so much force and so much devotion that if you actually can dream of being something else in your life, better off to do that. Because you'll just, you know, it's hard. It takes a lot.
That's wonderful. No, it is true. You have to really, it's something you have to really, really want. The good news is the people who do want it have the capability to inspire and entertain. And so for an Out of Me movie, we are all really looking forward to see Rob the Mom. It's going for limited release in March, and then they're doing wider release in April. And we will probably be dissecting it here, so I might be giving you some calls after I see it, being like,
I'd love it.
Explain. I need more information, more details.
Well, I won't be able to find my way out of this labyrinthian office you have, so just find me somewhere in this complex.
I'll find you in one of like the closets.
Yeah, with the popcorn rooms. In the corner and, yeah.
Some sort of pizza.
Yeah.
Who knows? Well, thank you so much.
It was my great pleasure.
I had a wonderful time. Everyone, we owe so much gratitude to Raymond. Again, thank you, and we're so excited to see this film. Everybody, Rob the Mob.
March 21, March 28.
Look
somewhere,
out for
somewhere around there.
March 21st. There we go.
From producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the rest of the Anatomy of a Movie staff, we would like to thank you for listening and subscribing to the show. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to email or tweet us. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been Anatomy of a Movie.
Thanks for watching Anatomy of a Movie on YouTube. For more on your favorite movies, subscribe to our channel here and be sure to let us know what you think in our comment section below here. Bye.